You good?
Committee will come to order. Good morning. The House Armed Services Committee meets today to receive testimony from members of Congress on their national defense priorities for fiscal year 2015 National Defense Authorization Act. Chairman McKeon's been called to handle other committee responsibilities this morning and will hopefully be joining us once we're underway. Without objection, we'll enter his prepared opening statement at this point in the record. One quick note for our format today, in consultation with the ranking member, we'll depart from our regular questioning process. Each witness will have 4 minutes to testify. Members of the committee may seek recognition by raising their hand or notifying the staff and will be granted 2 minutes each up to the 4 minute limit. This will ensure we can hear from all our witnesses in a timely fashion. As this hearing is intended to be a listening session, it is not our intent to engage in extended debate or colloquy with our witnesses. But we do appreciate all our colleagues coming today and hearing their priorities. With that, I'll yield to the distinguished ranking member.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I don't have any opening comments except to say that I look forward to the comments from the members from outside of the committee. We strive on this committee to represent the entire Congress, obviously, so we want to hear what you're interested in, and as we get ready to produce the National Defense Authorizing Act, those opinions and issues that you raise will be very important as we consider what the final product should look like and debate amendments and the bill on, I believe it's May 7th. So, timely hearing. Look forward to the testimony.
I thank the gentleman. And with that, we will start appropriately from the great state of Texas. Gentleman from Texas, Mr. O'Rourke, is recognized for 4 minutes.
Mr. Chair, Ranking Member Smith, members of the committee, thank you for the opportunity to testify before you today. I have the distinct honor of representing El Paso, Texas, which is home to Fort Bliss and the Army's 1st Armored Division. 29,000 soldiers and their families call Fort Bliss and El Paso home. Fort Bliss also has a unique relationship with White Sands Missile Range and Holloman Air Force Base, making the region one of the most important for our military. The three installations encompass more than 3.3 million acres and nearly 10,000 square miles of airspace. Together, they provide an unrivaled strategic advantage to our military for its training and testing and evaluation needs, an advantage that cannot be replicated elsewhere. Today, I will testify on 4 issues that are important to our region and important to our country's security. The first is on the issue of the budget. And in these uncertain times, I believe that Fort Bliss offers the Army opportunities to adapt, innovate, and achieve its near-term readiness priorities. Fort Bliss, in partnership with the community, has built the largest inland water desalination facility in North America. Building on that commitment to sustainability, the installation has committed itself to achieve net zero waste, water, and energy by December 31, 2018. These innovations will not only save the Army money, they will also make the post fully sustainable long into the future. Fort Bliss is capable of training virtually any type of unit in the Army force structure. Along with the restationing of the 1st Armored Division in 2005, the post also seamlessly received several brigade combat teams and numerous supporting units. This committee can be confident that Fort Bliss, along with White Sands Missile Range and Holloman Air Force Base, will continue to play a critical role in our country's national defense for decades to come, no matter what the budget situation. The second issue is Fillmore Canyon and a requested land transfer. The Department of the Army has identified the Fillmore Canyon land transfer as a high priority for the NDAA. The proposal will ensure that Fort Bliss and White Sands are protected from encroachment and have the buffer necessary to continue their training missions in the area. This proposal would transfer the Fillmore Canyon to the jurisdiction of the Bureau of Land Management and withdraw BLM land on the south and west boundaries of the Fort Bliss, Doña Ana training areas and firing range complex from disposal to a third party, such as a private development company. I urge the support of this committee for the inclusion of this land transfer authority in the NDAA. Next issue is Beaumont Hospital. Thanks to the past work of this committee, the new William Beaumont Army Medical Center is under construction and on schedule to start serving service members in 2017 as a new state-of-the-art facility. The hospital has 3 remaining phases of construction, and the timely completion of the new hospital is dependent on the funding of future increments through FY16. I ask this committee to continue your strong support for this project and the remaining funding increments. Last issue is the issue of transitioning service members. As a member of the Veterans Affairs Committee, I understand the numerous issues transitioning service members face. Of critical importance is ensuring that they have access to health care through the VA. I hope that this committee will consider the Healthy Transitions for Veterans Act, H.R. 3045, which I introduced last year. The proposal would require the Department of Defense to perform two simple, common sense tasks. The first, provide a comprehensive physical examination to all service members of the active, guard, and reserve components who are separating from military service. And secondly, provide separating service members with a copy of their complete medical records electronically. These changes will improve the transition for our soldiers, and it has been endorsed by over 14 veteran service organizations and is co-sponsored by 6 members of the committee, 4 of them Republican and 2 Democrat. I look forward to working with you on this proposal. Thank you again for the opportunity to testify today, and in his absence, I'd also like to thank Chairman McKeon for his decades of service, both in Congress and on the committee, and should you have any questions, I'm here to answer them. Thank you.
Thank the gentleman for his testimony. Are there any questions? If not, thank you, sir. Appreciate you being here. Let's see, next we have the gentlelady from North Carolina, Ms. Elmers. And I should have said at the beginning, without objection, all of the written statements that our witnesses provide will be made part of our record. Ms. Elmers, thanks for being here. You're recognized for 4 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and Ranking Member Smith, for allowing me to testify today in the House Armed Services Committee. I truly appreciate this opportunity. Since I have numerous issues I wish to draw attention to, I will keep my remarks brief on each issue. My staff will be happy to follow up on any of these issues and provide necessary information. I am the proud representative of the 2nd District of North Carolina, which is home to Fort Bragg. I am very honored to be representing Fort Bragg. Fort Bragg is home to the Airborne and Special Operation Forces. The first issue I would like to address is the President's proposal to inactivate the 440th Airlift Wing located at Pope Field. I have serious concerns with this proposal and the negative impacts it would have on training. The 440th Airlift Wing provides 33% of crucial joint airborne and air transportability training to the forces stationed at Fort Bragg. This joint commission was formed over the last 7 years to provide airborne and special operation forces with the accessible, flexible, and quality training they need to continue to be ready for whatever mission they are asked to carry out. Eliminating the ability to rapidly mobilize to train and deploy with local commanders, air crew, and aircraft that have an established relationship with our most in-demand forces increases risk at an unacceptable rate. Mr. Chairman, I respectfully request you maintain the mission of the 440th Airlift Wing and its C-130s. My next issue that I'd like to speak about has to do with TRICARE. I would like to discuss the issue and the lack of timely and consistent notification from TRICARE regarding changes made to beneficiaries' insurance coverage. While sitting down with one of my military spouses, Susan Reynolds, I was stunned to learn that her family was not notified about TRICARE's decision to end coverage for compounded pharmaceuticals. Her son, Ian, is allergic to red dye and relies on compounded pharmaceuticals for his medications. Mrs. Reynolds' husband, Jeremy, was deployed in less than a month and was blindsided by the changes made to his family's TRICARE coverage. The Reynolds family was left with the struggles of deployment and unnecessary burdens of wondering if their son's medication would be covered and how they would be able to replace it. This was an unnecessary hardship placed on the backs of the deployed family simply because there is no standard notification system in place to changes of TRICARE coverage. After speaking with numerous military families like the Reynolds, I introduced H.R. 4101, the TIME Act. This legislation would reconstruct TRICARE's notification process and require TRICARE to notify beneficiaries and providers no less than 90 days before a change to their coverage is made. It is imperative that military families have the appropriate time they need to find suitable alternatives for the coverage lost. Instead, they were left to see their insurance coverage pulled out from underneath them. Mr. Chairman, I request that this problem be addressed in this year's NDAA and that the Time Act be a part of that discussion. I would like to work with the House Armed Services Committee to fix this problem. In closing, I believe it is more important than ever that the United States maintain its military superiority and continue to be the dominant force of freedom in the world. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for this opportunity, and Ranking Member Smith, for allowing me to speak before this distinguished committee, and for all of your hard work and support of our armed services and military families. I look forward to working with the committee on the challenges facing our military. Thank you.
Great. Thank you. Appreciate the testimony of the gentlelady. Are there any questions? Not? Thank you.
Thank you.
Appreciate you being here. Next, a gentleman from Georgia, Mr. Collins. Appreciate the gentleman being here. Recognized for 4 minutes. If the gentleman...
There we go. We got it.
There you go.
I thought it was pushed. My bad. It's good to be here, and as a member of the still active Air Force Reserve, this committee is special to me, and I appreciate all the work that you, Mr. Thornberry, and Ranking Member Smith would give. I appreciate the opportunity to testify this morning before your committee. Words cannot express how proud I am of having in my district one-third of the famed U.S. Army Ranger School. The 5th Ranger Training Battalion is located in the beautiful mountains of Dahlonega, Georgia, home also to America's first gold rush, but I'm not here to discuss that. Camp Frank D. Merrill, located on 282 acres of land, houses the mountain phase of Ranger School. The camp is comprised of 200 active duty soldiers, a dining facility, a PX, commissary, chapel, and mountaineering equipment. Most importantly, Camp Merrill houses over 200 soon-to-be Rangers who are deprived of food, sleep, and comforting amenities in order to best serve our country and offer themselves as a fighting force. After World War II, the U.S. Army leased the 282-acre tract of land from the U.S. Forestry Service in order to construct the second phase of Ranger School. In 1951, Army USFS special use permit was drafted, and the Army has operated on the land under the supervision of the Forestry Service since then. The special use permit has enacted two layers of business rules and operating procedures for Camp Merrill, one Army layer and one Forest Service layer. The duplicative nature of management causes delays on critical infrastructure projects and unnecessarily complicates day-to-day operations. Ranger School's operational tempo and mission at Camp Merrill is an understandably unique one. The Army's mission at Camp Merrill requires a very specific building and maintenance standards calling for exemptions to regulatory guidance for which the Army already has standing operating procedures in place for. Once approvals for exemptions are processed through the military channels, the Forest Service then vets any changes to Camp Merrill's structure. This has happened at increased cost to U.S. taxpayers. The goal in acquiring Camp Merrill for the Army is to increase efficiency and to save taxpayer money. Wholly owning Camp Merrill allows any needed structural improvements and Ranger training facilities upgrades to occur cheaper than operating under two levels of bureaucracy. One example of bureaucratic senselessness is when a group of trees surrounding a landing zone for helicopters started to cause a safety hazard and needed trimming. Due to the two-level approval process of structural and environmental changes required by dual management of Camp Merrill, 2 years went by before approval was granted to trim the trees within an acre and a half area. In addition to the protracted time to accomplish this simple task, the cost for trimming the trees would nearly doubled. While we're on cost, the bureaucratic redundancy is occurring at a period when DOD is looking to capitalize on savings. The last 9 projects the Army built at Camp Merrill cost $674,980 more, due to repeated and unnecessary oversight by the United States Forestry Service. While this may appear a minuscule amount of money, remember, a redundant approval process can be traced back for over 50 years. My legislation reverses decades of redundant oversight and enacts a land exchange between the Department of Army and the Forestry Service. This exchange will allow the Army to gain administrative control of Camp Merrill, and Forestry Service gets new lake property on Lake Lanier. For over 20 years, two agencies engaged in several rounds of negotiation to enact the land transfer, and as recent as 2012, language was inserted into NDAA to bring the long-needed change. At the last moment, the language was stripped out because the Department of Agriculture reneged on the deal by asking for $10 million in addition to the land on Lake Lanier. The Army was not able to provide the money, and shouldn't have, by the way, as it was not part of the originally mutually decided upon agreement. 2014 is the year the saga should come to an end. With the passage of this language, the Army is empowered to build the structures needed to train one of the Army's most elite fighting forces. In addition to taxpayer monies, are relieved by duplicative agency oversight, and the Forestry Service gains land it previously didn't own. It is time, Mr. Chairman, for this to end, and it's time for two government agencies to settle a 20-plus year old dispute and save money at the same time. And Mr. Chairman, I yield back and thank you so much.
Thank you. Appreciate your testimony. Are there any questions? Thank you, Mr. Collins. Appreciate you being here. Next, the gentleman from Florida, Mr. Posey. Thanks for being here. You're recognized for 4 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and Mr. Ranking Member and committee members. I appreciate the opportunity to testify before you this morning. I appreciate the work you do in crafting the National Defense Authorization Act. In addition to this testimony, I will also submit a letter outlining priorities I believe are worthy of your consideration, and hope you'll allow me just to highlight a few of them for you here this morning. First, I'd like to thank the committee for recognizing the importance of the national importance of having a safe, secure, reliable, and modern space launch range infrastructure to support the national security space mission in the fiscal year 2014 NDAA. Last year, I testified on the importance of urging the Air Force to take steps to ensure that the Range Communications Building, also known as the XY Building at Cape Canaveral Air Force Station, is in sufficient shape to support our nation's space launches. The deplorable condition of this building, with its structural problems, flooding issues, outdated vacuum tube technology, believe it or not, must be addressed. I understand the Air Force rates this as their number one current mission MILCON priority for 2013 to 2016. Please continue, I hope, to urge the Air Force to prioritize resources as appropriate to modernize this vital launch infrastructure. Second, I'd like to ask the committee to include in the NDAA a common sense provision that passed the House last year on a voice vote as part of an en bloc amendment relating to space available military transport. Unfortunately, this provision did not make it through the Senate or the conference process. It simply allows nonprofit organizations to ship items to U.S. service members serving overseas on a space available basis. A similar policy is in place for sending cargo to foreigners under the detention program. This provision previously adopted by the House gives the Secretary of Defense the authority to do this for our own troops. Next, I understand that there may be requests to the committee that would require the Army to execute the fiscal year 2014 appropriated funds for an additional non-competitive procurement for the Army's Joint Tactical Radio Handheld MANPAC and Small Form Fit Program, JTRS. Without getting too technical, I'd urge the committee to instead continue the successful approach of last year and years before and promote competition in the procurement process. Competition saves money, and in this case, it also drives competition. Sole source does neither. In closing, I'd ask the committee to support the Army's network modernization with the Small Airborne Networking Radio Program, the continuation of a successful JSTARS fleet with the T-3 test aircraft, and the proper utilization of the Kiowa Warrior in last year's of availability for the warfighter. It includes upgrades to ensure that if called into action, our troops would have the best equipment possible. I appreciate very much your consideration of these requests.
Thank the gentleman for testimony. Gentleman from Florida, Mr. Nugent, is recognized for 2 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, Mr. Posey. You bring up some very important issues, particularly to the state of Florida on your first as it relates to the space launch ability at our facility there. I mean, we have 2 decades worth of experience in space launch, and I just want to thank you for bringing this forward. But, you know, beyond a range communication building, what other programs need new authorization to preserve and improve our space launch in Florida, particularly since we're so dependent today on Russia, which has not turned out to be all that dependable?
Well, I thank the gentleman for that question. You know, all space launches are matters of national security, not just perceived in a traditional manner that we look at national security, but as economic national security. I mean, take a few satellites out and, you know, you no longer get your weather report, you no longer can use your GPS, you no longer can use a cell phone, you no longer can use a credit card, you no longer can process a check. I mean, these are significant, you know, economic dangers to our economy and to our society. There's a lot of discussion in the Space Science and Technology Committee how to best spend the money on space. But in this particular issue, the XY building, literally, I would invite any of you sometime to visit it. The technology that we're using for tracking and ultimately our destruct systems hinge on it are truly vacuum tube technology. I mean, if you saw it, you would not believe that we're operating the Kennedy Space Center and the Cape Canaveral Air Force Station with this outdated technology or the condition of the building. It's truly frightening to me as a matter of national security.
Well, I want to thank the gentleman from Florida for bringing that forward.
Thank you,
back.
Sir.
Other questions? Thank the gentleman for being here. Chairman. Appreciate it. Next, we have the gentleman from Puerto Rico. Appreciate you being here. Recognized for 4 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Ranking member, members of the committee. Thank you for the opportunity to testify. I have two requests, which I'll summarize. First, congressional action is needed to address a significant threat to public safety on the island of Culebra, Puerto Rico, which was used as a military training range for many decades. DOD argues that a 1974 law precludes it from funding the cleanup of a 570-acre parcel, much of which was conveyed to the government of Puerto Rico back in 1982. Culebra is the only defense site in the nation that DOD says it is barred by statute from decontaminating. In the last several years, DOD and some members of Congress have opposed bicameral efforts to repeal or relax the 1974 law. This opposition flies in the face of well-established federal policy that DOD is responsible for funding remedial action on property contaminated by its training activities. It is also difficult to understand since CBO confirms that effective cleanup could be conducted for $6 million. The current state of affairs on Culebra is a disaster waiting to happen because the parcel contains popular beaches, pedestrian walkways, and campgrounds. Since 1995, there have been over 70 incidents in which members of the public encountered unexploded munitions that could have caused grave harm. Indeed, in January, local authorities had to close a beach when they discovered a 100-pound unexploded bomb underwater close to shore. Last week, the Corps of Engineers issued a press release warning spring break travelers to Culebra to exercise caution during their stay and to be on the lookout for any items that could be potential munitions, noting that the likelihood of encountering munitions on Culebra is relatively high. This committee has been actively engaged on this issue in the past. The House version of the 2010 NDAA repealed the 1974 law to authorize cleanup of the parcel, but the House receded in conference. The 2011 NDAA required a comprehensive DOD study on this issue, which DOD completed in April 2012. In the 2012 NDAA, I offered a successful floor amendment expressing the sense of the House that the 1974 law should be relaxed or repealed if the parcel could be cleaned at a reasonable cost, which it absolutely can. But again, the final bill was silent on the issue. I respectfully ask the committee to again include language to modify the 1974 law and to defend this provision in conference. I would like to work with Chairman McKeon, Ranking Member Smith, and Chairman Whitman to accomplish this goal. I have been trying to resolve this matter for 5 years. I cannot rest until it is properly addressed because the stakes are too high. My second request relates to the budget line for counter-drug activities. No U.S. jurisdiction is more affected by the drug trade than Puerto Rico, which is a major transshipment point for drugs destined for the U.S. mainland. The murder rate in Puerto Rico is far worse than any state, and most of the violence is linked to narcotics. The defense title of the 2014 Consolidated Appropriations Act expresses concern about drug-related violence in Puerto Rico and requires DOD to brief Congress on the steps it is taking to support law enforcement operations in the U.S. territory. I am concerned the DOD has requested only $719 million for interdiction activities in 2015, compared to the current funding level of $895 million. DOD must request and receive more robust funding in order to adequately perform this vital mission. Accordingly, I hope the committee will provide increased funding so that Southcom has more of the maritime and aviation assets it needs to prevent major shipments of narcotics from entering the U.S. and destroying the lives of American citizens. Thank you.
Thank the gentleman. Are there any questions? If not, appreciate your testimony. Thanks
You're
for
welcome.
Being here. Next, we have a gentleman from Florida, Mr. DeSantis. Appreciate you being here. You're recognized for 4 minutes. Thank you,
Chairman, Ranking Member Smith, and members of the committee. I appreciate your time. I know it's a busy time for the committee. I'm here to talk about the E-2D Advanced Hawkeye, the Navy's carrier-based airborne early warning and battle management command and control system. This particular E-2 platform has been serving our military well since the 1960s, and as you consider the FY15 authorization for DOD, I ask that you support the E-2D program as well as an additional fifth E-2D Advanced Hawkeye aircraft. The E-2D is equipped with new cutting-edge communications capabilities and radar systems. These advancements enable the E-2D to synthesize information from multiple onboard and offboard sensors to provide increased missile protection to our carrier defense groups while also improving the aircraft's offensive capabilities, which are key to supporting our combatant commands. The addition of the fifth E-2D aircraft in FY15 is necessary for providing carrier strike groups with the E-2D's advanced integrated air and missile defense capabilities to face the rapidly evolving Pacific threat. Without this fifth aircraft, carrier will be forced to deploy with less advanced E-2Cs, preventing carriers from having the additional capability that E-2Ds bring against multiple threats. Furthermore, additional funding would be needed to keep multiple variants of the Hawkeye in service longer. The program is critical for the Navy and our military. One of the members of this committee and our colleague, Congressman Bridenstine, put it well. Given the threat to the strike groups, multi-year procurement of E-2D is absolutely necessary. The only question is, are we purchasing enough E-2Ds and missile interceptors to counter the high volumes of incoming missiles that our soldiers and sailors and soldiers could face? And you know, Jim is a former E-2C pilot, so he really sees the advancements in capability with the E-2D. It's met every major milestone on schedule since the program's inception in 2003. And as the program moves forward, full funding for the E-2D as well as funding for a fifth aircraft ensures that carrier air wings will fully realize the capabilities provided by the state-of-the-art early warning and battle management command and control weapon system. The role technology plays in modern warfare is very important, and the technological advances of the E-2D will ensure that our military maintains its critical edge. Your support for this program is essential to maintaining the safety of our carriers in a changing environments when we are facing new threats. Thank you for having me here today, and thank you for what you do to support our nation's warfighters.
The gentleman from Florida, Mr. Nugent, is recognized for 2 minutes.
Oh, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Mr. DeSantis. Could you, it's disappointing that the President's budget eliminated one of these aircraft. Can you explain to us, or at least to me, why is it so important? I mean, why is it so important, the difference between a C and a D? I mean, it's a letter, so if you could.
Sure. The E-2 generally has been the eyes of the fleet. Yeah. One of the greatest capabilities we have just as a Navy guy, one of the things I was most proud of was to be able to take an aircraft carrier, sovereign U.S. territory, and put it anywhere on the seas and project power from there. But you can't just do that without knowing what the threats that you're facing. And so the E-2 has historically proven to be that platform that can identify the threats. I think what the E-2D brings is the capability is just so much greater. So we would need to increase capability anyways because the threats are stealthier than they have been in the past. But I think what the E-2 does is it obviously keeps up with that, and then it puts us even at a greater competitive advantage considering some of the threats that we're facing. So it really does bring great capabilities to the fight.
Well, and particularly you talked about in the Pacific theater, You know, there was just a comment, I believe it was in the paper today, from China that, you know, basically challenging us as it relates to our ability to operate within the Pacific theater and their growing capacity and capability. So I would think the E-2D certainly gives at least our forces, and particularly those that are attached to a carrier group, a whole lot more protection and the ability, if faced with a fight, to prevail. And so I appreciate you bringing this forward. Thank you.
Other questions? Thank the gentleman for your testimony. Appreciate you being here. Just alert members, a couple things are happening. Number one, we're moving along efficiently. Number two, some of the witnesses have been detained in other committee hearings, and so I think we'll be resuming here in just a moment. Appreciate the gentleman from New York being with us. We've already gotten unanimous consent for any written statement or materials to be made part of the record, and we are asking witnesses to summarize their testimony in 4 minutes. So with that, the gentleman's recognized. If you don't mind hitting the button for the...
I'm sorry. Thank you for the invitation to testify before the committee today. I come before you first to advocate for the thousands of veterans who served at Fort McClellan, Alabama, and are seeking to know whether their service time there made them ill. Shortly after I was first elected to Congress in 2008, I met with a constituent named Sue Frazier, who had served at Fort McClellan in the 1970s as part of the Women's Army Corps. Sue described for me the numerous health problems she had experienced since her time at Fort McClellan, including fibromyalgia, autoimmune disorders, and asthma. Most significantly, Sue had to undergo a hysterectomy at age 37. Sue's story is not an isolated one. As my office began to investigate this issue further, we've heard from hundreds of vets from all over the country who served at Fort McClellan that are experiencing similar health issues consistent with PCB exposure. I have introduced legislation that would notify those who served at Fort McClellan of potential contamination and create a voluntary health study to assess the validity of their claims. This issue has gained the support of 52 co-sponsors, including members of both parties on this committee. I want to personally thank those of you on this committee, on both sides of the aisle, that have lent your support to this pro-veteran legislation. Our mission here is simple, obtaining basic information. Unfortunately, after 5 long years and support from many members of this committee, we are still stalled. We have yet to have a hearing or a vote on this important issue, and this inaction has a price while we wait. These veterans become sicker. This is an issue that deserves debate in an open forum. I do not pretend to have all the answers, and I'm happy to work with anyone from either party to find a solution to this issue. However, what we cannot do is continue to turn a blind eye to those veterans who are simply seeking to understand why they are so sick. Caring for our veterans is a top priority, and this is a debate worth having. I urge this committee to consider language in the NDAA to address the needs of the Fort McClellan veterans. I also hope you will include language based on my bill in H.R. 337, which bears the name of Lieutenant Colonel Todd Clark, an Albany, New York native who was tragically killed in action on June 8, 2013. Todd wished to be buried at Fort Sam Houston in Texas. However, his family also wanted to have a hometown service to allow friends and family the opportunity to honor him. They were shocked to learn that they would be responsible for defraying part of the cost of transporting their son's body from Albany to San Antonio. Currently, it is the department's policy to only provide one flight at government expense for deceased service members. In this case, DOD paid for transport from Dover Air Force Base to Albany, but was unable to cover the cost to San Antonio. I have suggested allowing for one stopover en route to final destination. This would enable service members who wish to be buried in a national cemetery to have a hometown memorial service without worrying about the cost of transportation. This stopover would be completely optional. I understand that DOD cannot be asked to fulfill burdensome requests, such as many flights crisscrossing our nation. One stopover represents a reasonable compromise that insulates the department from extravagant costs while allowing families greater flexibility to fulfill their loved one's last wishes. Some will argue that families should use the $100,000 death gratuity to cover this expense, but I believe for a family that has just lost a loved one on behalf of our nation, that money is better spent on mortgage payments, college funds, and rebuilding their lives. The cost of funeral arrangements is the last thing they should be worrying about. Truthfully, I do not know how many people have paid this expense or changed their arrangements to avoid extra costs, but I do know that the Clarks are not alone. When a service member and his or her family make the ultimate sacrifice, the least we can do is make sure family and friends have ample opportunity to honor and memorialize their loved one. How we treat our fallen heroes and those who grieve for them says a lot about us as a nation and the debt we owe our veterans. All I am asking is that we do a little bit more. Thank you again to the chair and the committee for hearing my testimony today. I would be happy to answer any questions or follow up with additional information you may require. Thank you.
Great. Thank the gentleman. Are there any questions? If not, appreciate the gentleman being here and raising these issues.
Thank you, Chair.
We're ready to resume. Appreciate the gentleman from Missouri, Chairman of the Small Business Committee, being with us, Mr. Graves, and you're recognized for 4 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate it, and I appreciate the work that the committee's doing. Given that the federal government spends nearly $500 billion each year on contracts, the federal procurement market is incredibly important for all of the small businesses. Improving small business opportunities for federal contracts is a triple play. The small businesses win more contracts, workers win because small businesses create jobs, and the taxpayers win because the competition saves the government money and it improves the health of the industrial base. Over the last 3 years, the Armed Services Committee and the Small Business Committee have worked together on procurement issues, and I'm pleased to report this collaboration is working very well. For the first time in 8 years, it appears that the federal government met its small business goal. However, there's still a great deal of work to be done to ensure that the contracting community has the tools and guidance it needs to get the best results, and that small businesses don't face unnecessary burdens and barriers to the entry in the procurement process with the federal government. And to that end, the Small Business Committee recently marked up 5 bills aimed at further improving the competitive viability of our industrial base, and I introduced a 6th bill that has not been marked up yet. But I believe these initiatives, all of which have bipartisan support, tie into the recommendation presented to this committee in 2012 by the Panel on Business Challenges in the Defense Industry, which is led by Mr. Schuster and Mr. Larson. The small business bills should complement the efforts of the Armed Services Committee in this Congress. Therefore, I'm here today to support the inclusion of these 6 bills in this year's National Defense Authorization Act, and I detail them each of the initiatives in my written statement, but I'll just briefly mention them here. The first 3 bills seek to make general improvements to the small business programs. The first addresses the treatment of veterans and service-disabled veterans seeking to do business with the government by improving the verification process with these firms. The second bill tackles the lack of reliable data on the contract bundling and consolidation process, which are practices that unnecessarily preclude small businesses from competing for contracts. And the third bill is a provision embraced by this committee in the fiscal year 2013 defense authorization, which raises the government-wide small business contracting goal from 23% to 25%. And spending levels decrease. This is going to protect small businesses at the heart of the industrial base. The remaining 3 bills focus on challenges for small business in the construction industry. The first makes it easier for small businesses to obtain the necessary bonding to compete, and does so at no cost to the taxpayer. The second takes the lessons learned from the policy enacted by the Corps of Engineers on reverse auctions and expands them government-wide to protect small businesses and the taxpayers alike. And the third improves the way we conduct design-build contracting to decrease the cost to government while it increases small business opportunities. This last bill is pending before the Committee on Oversight and Government Forum, which I understand that committee of jurisdiction has to be consulted. The first 5 bills received bipartisan support in the committee, passed by voice vote, and are supported by numerous small business groups. And the final bill has support from agencies, industry, and the bipartisan group of members. Each bill supports the intentions, if not specific recommendations, of the panel report produced by this committee last Congress. And most importantly, each bill provides more opportunity to small businesses to create jobs at a price that is in the best interest of the taxpayers. I'm pleased that our two committees are working very well together and very cooperatively, and I hope this language can be incorporated into this year's defense authorization. With that, I thank you for your time.
Any questions? Gentleman from Colorado, recognized for 2 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to thank Chairman Graves for appearing before the committee today. I would also like to offer my thanks for your support for the inclusion of House Resolution 282882, the Improving Opportunities for Service-Disabled Veteran-Owned Small Businesses Act, in the 2014 National Defense Authorization Act. The Small Business Administration and the Department of Veterans Affairs both verify the status of service-disabled veteran-owned small businesses. As a member of the House Small Business Committee and the House Veterans Affairs Committee, I have heard numerous stories from veterans about problems with the current procurement programs for service-disabled veteran small businesses. Under the current system, a company can qualify at one agency and not another for procurement preferences. The inconsistency often adds cost, confusion, and opens the door to fraud. Moreover, the current process requires the VA to make decisions that are outside their expertise, such as determining business structures. My legislation will transfer the VA verification process for firms to the SBA, unify the definitions of service-disabled small businesses and veteran-owned small businesses, and add transparency. I want to again thank Chairman Graves for coming to this committee today. I urge the committee to accept Chairman Graves' request for the inclusion of these small business measures in the National Defense Authorization Act, including my legislation, H.R. 2882. And with that, I yield back.
Other questions? Appreciate the gentleman being here. Thank you.
Thanks, Mr. Chairman.
Next, we have a gentleman from New York, Mr. Hanna. Gentleman's recognized for 4 minutes.
Thank you. Good morning, Chairman Thornberry, Ranking Member Smith, and other members of the committee. Thank you for taking the time to listen to me today. Over the course of almost 30 years in private business, I grew a small firm from the ground up that employed over 450 people over time and successfully completed thousands of commercial and municipal projects in upstate New York. Given that experience, I know how important small business construction contracting is. It is an industry where small business can grow into large businesses. Construction contracting builds communities. However, there are a few small areas where the federal government's policies on construction contracting hurt small businesses, taxpayers, and agencies themselves. This is particularly important given the scope of federal construction contracting. Construction and architect and engineering, or A&E contracting, represents about 1 in 6 prime contractor dollars awarded to small business. That was over $17 billion in prime contracts in the first fiscal year of 2012. Therefore, as chairman of the Subcommittee on Contracting and Workforce of the Small Business Committee, I've introduced 2 bills this Congress and co-sponsored a 3rd intended to bring some common sense reform to this area. I'll discuss them briefly, but want you to, and I'm asking you to include them in this year's National Defense Authorization Act. The first, H.R. 776, the Security and Bonding Act of 2013, addresses surety bonding. As the construction projects get larger, it becomes harder for these small businesses to obtain necessary bonding to bid these projects. In these cases, they are sometimes forced to turn to disreputable sureties who issue worthless bonds that place the taxpayers at risk. This is a no-cost bill that makes it easier for small businesses to get legitimate bonds and that makes sure that all bonds are worth more than the paper on which they are written. This makes sure that agencies get a quality construction job and that taxpayers get what they pay for and small businesses get paid. The other 2 bills I want to discuss address the way we contract with A&E. The first is reverse auctions. While there is evidence that reverse auctions can be a good way to buy commodities, 2 studies by the Army Corps of Engineers demonstrated that it doesn't work for construction. Services contracts. Therefore, I introduced 2751, the Common Sense Construction Contract Act of 2013. This bill takes the lessons learned from the Army Corps of Engineers and applies them to other federal agencies. Likewise, the Corps has also led the way on design-build contracting, implementing a 2-phase approach to procurement. Given the cost of bidding for design work, the 2-phase approach allows more businesses to compete and saves the government money. Unfortunately, all civilian agencies have not learned from the Army Corps of Engineers experience. So I've co-sponsored 2750, the Design Build Efficiency and Jobs Act of 2013. This bill encourages other agencies to adopt the policies in the place of the Army Corps of Engineers. While I encourage you to include all of the contracting bills recently marked up by the Small Business Committee, given the significance of construction contracting, I hope you will incorporate 776, 2750, and 2751 into this year's National Defense Authorization Act. I'm happy to answer any questions.
Are there any questions, Mr. Hanna? Okay. Appreciate you being here. Thank you for your testimony.
Thank you for your time.
Next, we'll have the gentleman from Georgia, Mr. Brown. Gentleman is recognized for 4 minutes.
Thank you, Chairman Thornberry, Ranking Member Smith, and members of the committee. I thank you all for the opportunity to come and testify before you today. As an original intent constitutionalist, as well as a current Navy Reserve medical doctor, I view national security as the most important function of our federal government. While President Obama and many within his party would like to further cut our military and prioritize wasteful domestic spending over our national defense, I disagree with his approach. Instead, we should be strengthening our military and restoring its readiness in the face of ongoing geopolitical threats as well as non-conventional threats. To this end, I appreciate your efforts to counterbalance the Senate and the executive branch in the past and urge you to continue to do so. That being said, I continue to have deep concerns over how the 2001 Authorization for Use of Military Force Against Terrorists, the AUMF, is being utilized. This hastily crafted response to the September 11, 2001 terrorist attacks dramatically expanded the powers of the president, and yet few Americans are even aware of its existence. In just 60 words, the AUMF opened the door to egregious abuses of federal power. In particular, it allows for the indefinite detention of American citizens and broad, warrantless wiretapping by the National Security Agency. The AUMF also paved the way to today's shadow drone war under the Obama administration that has quietly claimed the lives of at least 4 Americans. I appreciate the operational advantage we gained from using drones in our military operations. I saw those when I was deployed to Afghanistan in 2012, and I view them as a valuable asset. But it is unconscionable for the U.S. government to kill its own citizens without first allowing them their day in court and due process. No administration has the right to be judge, jury, and executioner of American citizens. I was pleased that my amendment prohibiting drone strikes on American citizens was included in last year's NDAA as passed out of the House. But I'm deeply disappointed that the language was dropped in the compromise. As such, I respectfully urge the committee to include the language from my amendment while crafting this year's authorization, as well as other language to constrain the powers of the AUMF, such as Ranking Member Smith's proposed amendment to prohibit indefinite detention. Mr. Chairman, it is my understanding that the Judiciary Committee has jurisdiction over the AUMF itself. However, the Armed Services Committee can, in my opinion, should take the strongest possible action to prevent these specific abuses. At the same time, I hope the committee will include text in plain language, clearly showing Americans that these disturbing, overly broad powers come from the AUMF and not from the NDAA itself. We need to ensure that people across the country know what powers the federal government believes it has and what legal justification it presents for those powers. Our war efforts and military activities must be tightly focused and kept within the bounds of the U.S. Constitution. America is a beacon of liberty and a force for good in this world, only as long as we remained focused on keeping it that way. Liberty is too precious, and we must continue to be ever vigilant in protecting it. We must never sacrifice our God-given, constitutionally protected rights in the name of security or expediency. I'm hopeful that this year's NDA will stay true to these principles. Thank you again for the opportunity to testify you before today. I'm glad to answer questions.
Appreciate the gentleman being here to share his views. Are there any questions?
Thank you,
again,
Mr. Chairman.
Appreciate the gentleman. Next, we have the gentlelady from Tennessee, Ms. Blackburn. Appreciate you being with us today. Gentlelady's recognized for 4 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate the opportunity to come and to be with you and to talk a little bit about Tennessee's 7th Congressional District and the wonderful Army Post Fort Campbell, which is primarily headquartered in that district, and the brave men and women that call Fort Campbell home. We've got the 101st Airborne, the 5th Special Forces Group and the Army's 160th Special Operations Aviation Regiment. Nearly 3,500 officers and 27,000 enlisted personnel call Fort Campbell home. Like many installations across the country, Fort Campbell is facing reductions that will have an impact on military readiness as well as on the installation infrastructure. I was so pleased to work with you in this committee last year in support of the Army Flying Hours program. It's a vital program. It provides aviation training resources for individual crew members and units according to approved aviation training strategies. In addition, it also provides individual and collective proficiency in support of ongoing combat and non-combat air operations. For aviation units like the 101st Airborne, this training is not only vital to mission success, but to the safety of our soldiers. Due to Army budget constraints, Army aviators will only be provided with 10.1 hours of training per crew per month. This is below the recommended requirement of 12 and a half hours of training per crew per month. I ask the members of this committee to once again pay close attention to restoring the Army Flying Hours program to its full capacity in fiscal year 15. I would also like to bring to the committee's attention the great need for Army installation infrastructure funding. As members of this committee may very well know, DOD's model calls for a level of funding to cover 80 to 90% of the needs of an installation. Currently, installations like Fort Campbell will be reliant on only 62% of the required funding set forth by DOD's model. This reduction in funding, if left unaddressed, will surely result in higher future costs to repair these important facilities. I fully believe that our Army readiness infrastructure is a key component to our full military readiness and is one that must not be forgotten. I stand ready to work with the Army and the committee to address this important concern. Another issue that deserves the full attention of every member of this committee is that of security encroachment. I'm greatly concerned that foreign companies are building and acquiring projects near DOD ranges and facilities that give them the ability to monitor sensitive activities. I believe that we should look at amending the Committee on Foreign Investment in the U.S. process so that DOD is able to raise proximity and foreign entity concerns when it is a co-lead agency reviewing a transaction. It's imperative that DOD is able to assess potential security threats related to foreign acquisition or ownership of assets and has the ability to mitigate or prevent a transaction from moving forward. Thank you for allowing me to be with you, and I yield back the balance of my time.
Thank you, gentlelady. Are there any questions? If not, again, appreciate you being here.
Thank you.
Next, we have the gentleman from Washington, Mr. Heck. Appreciate your testimony. Gentleman's recognized for 4 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and Ranking Member Smith. And Mr. Chair, while I anticipated doing this on the floor, I cannot help but insert here that I spoke to my Aunt Catherine in Bowie last week, and she literally told me to tell you hello. So hello from my Aunt Catherine in Bowie, Texas. I thank the committee for allowing me to testify here today about our national defense priorities for the upcoming year. As the member of Congress from the brand new 10th Congressional District of Washington State, I have the privilege to represent Joint Base Lewis-McChord, one of the largest installations in the country. It is in the vicinity of Interstate 5 that JBLM is located. This highway is the most heavily traveled north-south freight corridor in the state of Washington, carrying some 145,000 vehicles per day. Some say it's the most congested choke point between Vancouver, Canada and Tijuana, Mexico. Nearly 80% of traffic to and from JBLM relies on I-5, 80%. Local travelers in neighboring cities have no other option except to use the interstate as an arterial. When incident occurs, it takes hours to recover. Backups of literally 6 miles or more starting at 6 a.m. are not rare, they're kind of expected. So take a moment, if you will, please, and imagine a van full of soldiers and civilian workers stuck on I-5. A truck directly behind the van could be full of goods waiting to be stocked on the shelves of a local warehouse, and in a car behind the truck behind the van is a mom with a crying child waiting to get to the doctor. Take these three vehicles, now multiply them into miles of traffic and thousands of people. Imagine them not just in Washington State, but also stuck on Florida's State Route 85, Interstate 95, 395, or 495 in the DC area. The almost daily question has become, what is the holdup? The truth is, military installations are still adapting to base realignment and short-term growth caused by troops passing through before being deployed. Installation growth has had a significant effect on regional transportation, particularly when an installation is located in an urban area. Even acknowledging the potential for drawdown in military bases, those reductions would not nearly come close enough to solving the problem. Surrounding roads play an important role in preserving military readiness. Our armed forces need to instantly deploy, and we need functional roads in order for that to happen. The domino effect of delays due to congestion impairs our national security. This leaves not only military activities on base stranded, but also commerce in the community stranded as well. Goods can't move, companies lose money. To be clear, the military is not to blame for this. In fact, they've done a lot to help mitigate the problem. They know the opportunity cost associated with their soldiers and civilian workers being stuck in traffic. Bases have come up with innovative approaches to ease the pain, but the problem remains severe and unavoidable without more investment. It is a Band-Aid over a wound that needs stitches. The only existing DoD program that provides funding for public highway improvements is the Defense Access Road Programs, DAR. It is limited by outdated and restrictive eligibility criteria. In fact, the DAR program began decades ago when it was expected that bases would only be in relatively unpopulated areas. Because of the restricted eligibility criteria, installation in urban areas, which feel the effects of installation growth more acutely, fail to qualify for DAR funding. Even when DAR applications are successful, it takes years. DAR also requires base commanders to choose between on-base projects or local roads, and that's not a fair decision, sir. Something should be done. And I ask that you consider upgrading the transportation improvement infrastructure around these bases as soon as possible as part of the FY15 National Defense Authorization Act. In coordination with state and local entities, the DAR program can be revised to pay the military's share of road improvements. A separate DOD program should also be established to fund the transit services necessary to meet the needs. Mr. Chairman, while I've been sitting here talking to you today, think back to that van, that truck, and that car. Chances are, just in the time I've been speaking, they've only advanced about 50 feet. There's probably still going to be gridlock when this hearing ends, as a matter of fact. I know being stuck in traffic is not something unknown to most Americans. We are all too familiar with the horrible feeling of approaching an unexpected slow crawl on the road. But when this affects our military's ability to get to base, to do the job, and to be ready for anything, that is when we can't just sit and wait for it to get better. We can do more. Please, sir, consider updating regulations to meet this critical need, or we will need to find another way to address this unsustainable problem and situation. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank the gentleman. The ranking member is recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I know how bad the situation is there, having previously represented that area. I was going to say, you know, it was just fine when I represented it, but that's not true. So it's a growing area. The base is growing. The population around it is growing. And I know that the folks at Lewis McCourt have done on-base improvements because there's a lot of areas where they can travel, stay on base instead of getting on the freeway. They've changed lights. They've tried to do a lot of things. Nothing that can be done unless there are improvements done on that piece of I-5. How would what you're asking for here dovetail with what could happen in a state transportation bill? You and I know how bogged down and terrible that process is. The state should have passed it a long time ago, but it's a huge priority. Eventually, they might. Has there been money in the various proposals that have thus far died on the state level that would help this problem that we could potentially leverage with federal funds?
Yes, Congressman Smith, there there was included in the version that was proposed in the Senate Majority Caucus Coalition substantial funds, and there were some funds included in the House passed version as well. The proposal that I am in the late stages of developing, which would reform DAR, would in fact, of necessity, have to dovetail with state and local efforts. They cannot go separately. This is a shared responsibility, which I fully recognize.
Absolutely, and I think that's our best approach, is to try to blend the different pieces and get enough money to hopefully improve the situation. But you describe it very accurately. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
Other questions? I appreciate the gentleman being here and your testimony. Next, gentlelady from California, Ms. Chu. Appreciate you being with us today. The gentlelady's recognized for 4 minutes.
Thank you, Chairman Thornberry and Ranking Member Smith, for the opportunity to testify today. First, I ask that my written testimony be entered into the record.
Yeah. All the witnesses' written testimony be made part of our record. Appreciate it, gentlemen.
Thank you. 6 days ago on April 3rd marked the third anniversary of the death of my nephew, Harry Liu. Harry was an enlisted Marine deployed to Afghanistan. He took his own life after enduring over 3 hours of degrading physical, abusive hazing by his fellow Marines. In the wake of his death, I learned that Harry's story is not an isolated incident. There are other brave, dedicated members of our armed services who were needlessly subjected to physical and emotional torment at the hands of their peers. I'm committed to ensuring that hazing in our nation's military is addressed by the Department of Defense. The military needs to create a bond within a unit and provide useful training. But instead, hazing breeds fear and distrust of peers and leadership. Where hazing results in death or harm, there is often no justice for the victims. For the future safety of our service members and our country, we must eliminate hazing outright. For the past 3 years, I have received encouraging support from the public, various advocacy groups, and fellow members of Congress. Together, we included language in the FY 2013 National Defense Authorization Act requiring the Department of Defense to report to Congress the manner in which hazing is reported, tracked, and prevented by each branch of the armed services. These reports revealed some startling trends and practices. First, substandard tracking systems result in unreliable data on hazing. Reports are unreliable because most branches do not track allegations or incidents of hazing separately from similar punishable offenses. Without a system solely in place to track hazing, the true scope of the problem remains unknown. Second, the branches that do not require hazing to be reported have more hazing incidents. The reports show that the branches with the highest numbers of hazing allegations do not require service members to report if they are hazed or witness hazing. It seems that policies that do not explicitly require service members to report hazing have thereby tacitly condoned the practice. This is a problem that must be rectified. Most importantly, much more information is needed. The lack of reliable statistics and other information in these reports underscores the need for an independent review of DoD hazing policies. As lawmakers, we must ensure we have objective, unbiased information on which to formulate policy. In light of the disclosures of the DoD hazing reports, I ask the committee to first request updated hazing reports from the Department of Defense. Most of the reports indicated recent or planned actions by the branches of service in their ongoing efforts to eliminate hazing. As we continue to refine and perfect DoD hazing policies, we will need the most up-to-date information on each branch's effort. An update to each branch's report will be crucial as we move forward. Secondly, I request that the Government Accountability Office conduct an independent review of hazing within the Department of Defense. A GAO review of hazing that identifies problems, trends, and best practices amongst the branches of the military is vital to a better understanding of the scope of the hazing problem. The importance of unbiased information in the effort to eliminate hazing in the military cannot be understated. For the FY 2015 National Defense Authorization Act, the inclusion of language requiring an independent analysis of DoD hazing policies is my top priority. The failure of Congress to follow through with our responsibility to provide civilian oversight of our nation's military would be a disservice to Harry and all those who have suffered or lost their lives as a result of hazing. As the committee begins crafting the 2015 National Defense Authorization Act, I urge you to consider the impact of hazing on morale, unit cohesion, combat readiness, and the health of our troops and veterans. Thank you for your consideration of this request.
Thank the gentlelady. Are there any questions? Thank you again for continuing to raise this issue and for being here today.
Thank you.
Appreciate the gentleman from Wisconsin, Mr. Ribble, being with us. We've already agreed to have your written statement made part of the record. The gentleman's recognized for 4 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I want to thank you and Ranking Member Mr. Smith for letting me have some time this morning. It's not my intention to read my testimony. It's already been submitted for the record. Good morning, Chairman McKeon. It's good to see you here as well. But I wanted to just talk a little bit about the littoral combat ships that are in part built in Marinette, Wisconsin. One of the concerns that I have as it relates to that, and I speak of it in my testimony, is that we're about to embark on a journey that could raise costs to the American taxpayer. Without regard to a determination about whether moving from 54 ships down to 32 ships, I look at how those ships are being purchased over time. If, in fact, the contract is broken for a four-ship purchase in fiscal year 2015, breaking that contract does two significant things, in my opinion. One is it opens up the Navy for an increased cost on the remaining ships that will be purchased, because each shipyard was promised two ships per year in each year. If the contract's broken, they then can go back and renegotiate whatever the price is for the ships. And here we have a program that at the initial first run, those ships were costing $650 million. They're now in a fixed contract price of $348 million. If we break that contract, the taxpayer will be subject to the difference in pricing, however they can negotiate with the Navy. Secondarily to that, it goes more toward the fact that we want, in this country, we want the private sector to invest in shipbuilding and in these shipyards. And in fact, private investment in the shipyard in Marinette, Wisconsin exceeds $200 million on the promise that the Navy was going to build two ships a year there during the term of this contract. And so I feel that if we're going to continue to incent American shipbuilding, which the Navy needs, and we're going to be fair and honest to those shipyards, keeping our word to the letter of the contract is fairly essential to that end. We do not want to create a pattern in this country whereby American entrepreneurs and business owners make investments on the promise of the American taxpayer through its government and then have those promises broken, because it will be a disincentive for American investment in the very types of things, our national defense, that is so essential to the American people. And with that, Mr. Chairman, that concludes my remarks this morning, and I thank you for the time.
Appreciate the gentleman raising this issue. Any questions? Great. Thanks again to the gentleman from Wisconsin.
Yes, thank you.
Gentlelady from New York, welcome to the committee. Your full written statement will be made part of the record, and the gentlelady is recognized for 4 minutes for whatever testimony you'd like to give.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman Thornberry, Ranking Member Smith, and members of the committee. Thank you for allowing me to testify on three bipartisan pieces of legislation that have the support of the House Small Business Committee. These common sense proposals would increase the level of fairness that should be expected in any programs the government is involved in. Combined, they help small businesses avoid unnecessary expenses when seeking a government contract, ensure the federal government is not being ripped off, and most importantly, remove from the federal procurement system the bad actors who corrupt it for those playing by the rules. Since I have only a few minutes and three bills to cover, my remarks will be brief. The Design, Build, Efficiency, and Jobs Act of 2013, H.R. 2750, would clarify when agencies should use a two-step process to buy design-build services. Design-build contracts offer well-documented benefits to the government, but can be very expensive to bid on, especially if the team is led by a small architect or engineer. Indeed, submitting a full proposal on one of these contracts routinely costs over $250,000. Given that most architects make less than $1 million each year, this excludes well-qualified firms from bidding. Some have joked that they would be better served by taking the money to a casino. H.R. 2750 addresses this problem by allowing any qualified company to submit a technical proposal, which is significantly less expensive than a full-blown proposal. After the agency evaluates these technical qualifications, only the top five firms will be asked to submit a full proposal. Therefore, they aren't wasting bid and proposal dollars and time on contracts that they have no chance of winning. The government also benefits from this approach, which has already been adopted by the Corps of Engineers. By having more companies submit initial proposals, the government gets a better pool of initial competitors. However, since the government only needs to evaluate five full proposals, the government saves time and effort overall. This is truly a win-win approach. Finally, the Security in Bonding Act of 2013, H.R. 776, addresses abuses of the surety bond process. Surety bonds are required whenever a company is doing construction work for the federal government, and these bonds ensure that the work is completed properly and that all subcontractors are paid. Unfortunately, there are well-documented cases where bad actors do not have the resources to back the bonds they issue, placing both the government and small subcontractors at risk. H.R. 776 requires that bonds be worth the paper they are printed on, and that small businesses have access to quality surety bonds. This is a zero-cost solution that protects all parties to federal construction projects. Also, the Common Sense Construction Contracting Act of 2013, H.R. 2751, improves the use of an often abused procurement method, reverse auctions. Although reverse auctions may be acceptable for commodities or small items, several Corps of Engineers studies show that they are unacceptable in the construction industry. The practice should be ended immediately. The legislation is supported by subcontractors and prime contractors alike and would result in a higher quality project for any federal agency. Reverse auctions are a prime example of failing businesses competing in a race to the bottom. They will bid on projects at impractical levels in an attempt to keep the business afloat for a few more months. The projects, if completed, are shoddy. The Army Corps of Engineers has stopped using reverse auctions for construction services, but this legislation would ensure that ban is in place amongst all the federal agencies. Thank you for your consideration of these bills. I hope you will strongly consider them for inclusion in this year's defense authorization.
Appreciate it. Are there any questions? Appreciate, again, gentlelady's testimony. Thanks for being here. Next, we'll have the gentleman from California, Mr. Lowenthal. Gentleman is recognized for 4 minutes.
Thank you, Chairman Smith, Chairman Thornberry and Ranking Member Smith, and members of the committee, all of you. Oh, yes. Thank you for allowing me this time to discuss with you the importance of STEM education for the Department of Defense, specifically the Starbase program. Providing science, technology, education, and math education to America's youth is critical to the global competitiveness of our nation. That we all agree upon. The Starbase program engages local fifth grade elementary students by exposing them to STEM subjects through an inquiry-based curriculum and is currently active in 56 congressional districts throughout the country. The program is carried out by the military services because the lack of STEM-educated youth in America has been identified as a future national security issue by the Department of Defense. Last year, both the House and the Senate rebuked the Office of Management and Budgets, their proposal to terminate this critical program. And today, I ask you once again to join me in restoring the Starbase program at a modest funding level of $30 million. The Department of Defense Starbase program is one of the most cost-effective programs throughout the federal government. It costs an average of only $343 per student. Last year, 3,062 classes were conducted in 1,267 schools among a diverse 413 school districts throughout the country. More than 70,000 students attended the program, bringing the total to over 825,000 since its inception in 1993. Starbase is one of the most educationally effective STEM programs as well. According to internal Department of Defense studies, they show that pre and post Starbase youths demonstrate undisputed improvements in STEM fields. Just as crucial is the positive dispositional change in youth that they experience after participating in this exciting, hands-on, experiment-based program. Changing our children's attitudes on math and science from negative to positive is a paramount achievement. Research shows that children begin to lose interest in STEM subjects as early as the fourth grade, and then subsequently they lose their motivation to select the necessary high school courses that will allow them to pursue STEM careers in college. As a member of Congress, I fully appreciate OMB's desire to consolidate STEM programs across the spectrum into one funding line. However, this is a national defense issue and has been identified as such by the Joint Chiefs of Staff. Starbase was created under the auspices of the Department of Defense to meet its critical needs in STEM-related fields. I respectfully request that this committee reinstate the Starbase program and authorize it at $30 million for this and for future years. In conclusion, Starbase inspires America's youth to discover technical career fields that are imperative for future national security challenges. We cannot lose this battle and concede our technical edge. And in conclusion, I can say I have visited my program. It is a wonderful program. These are students that would not be into science. It is one of the things that at our military base that the military does so well in bringing that kind of excitement to students that would never have that kind of motivation in the future. I think it is money well worth spent, and it's really in our nation's best interest to promote this program.
Great. Any questions? Mr. Nugent?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and Mr. Lowenthal. We had testimony in front of one of our subcommittees in regards to DOD the Pentagon making a decision to eliminate the program, even though one of the services continued to provide it. And I believe it was the United States Army continued to provide it. Because they felt that it was better to move it to Department of Education. And the interesting part about this conversation that we had with members of the Armed Services, they actually thought that it was probably a bad idea to move it to Department of Education because of the focus that's lost in regards to, you know, Department of Defense issues, and particularly in regards to, you know, getting kids excited about their ability and how it's so important to the national defense that it was, I think it was wrong-headed by DOD to make that decision.
I can just say I represent in Southern California, in Orange County, the Joint Forces Training Base, which has one of the Starbase programs. And it was, we just last year dedicated a new building to the program. And I cannot tell you how excited those students are when they leave that program. Also the military, in terms of the service that they provide to their community. I think that the uniqueness of targeting students who, many of them are at-risk students who would never go on to science and technology, but because it's done by the military, because it's done in a particular way, it really excites those students. And there is no doubt, in terms of our national security, we need these students to be involved in science, technology, engineering, and mathematics.
Well, I appreciate you bringing this to the attention of the committee, the whole committee. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Again, thank the gentleman for your testimony.
Thank you so much.
Appreciate you being with us.
I appreciate your listening.
Thank you. Next, we have the gentleman from Pennsylvania, Mr. Oh, I didn't even see you over there. Gentleman from Kentucky, Mr. Barrs, next. Your full written statement will be made part of the record, and you're recognized for 4 minutes for whatever testimony you'd like to give.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thanks for the opportunity to speak before the House Armed Services Committee today. Once again, I come before you in support of our active duty guard and reserve components, as well as our veterans, to help ensure they receive the equipment and support they deserve. I believe that the National Guard and reserve components are critical to our national security, and in order to safely and effectively complete their missions, they must be equipped with modern aircraft and the most updated avionics. I ask this committee to continue to help provide support for the National Guard and Reserve Equipment Account in order to help sustain accounts such as the Aircraft Modernization Program. In addition, one of my priorities is preventing reckless reductions of our military troop levels, especially within the Army National Guard. I respectfully ask that this committee postpone any decision that substantially impacts troop levels for the National Guard until the National Commission on the Structure of the Army publishes its final findings. This is too important to consider without the Commission's recommendation, given that the decision could have a lasting and harmful impact on our nation's readiness to engage threats to our allies and national security. As we proceed toward a drawdown, post-war drawdown, we ought to carefully consider not reducing the Guard and the Reserve components, which are the most cost-effective components of our military. Several issues of concern have also been raised by my 6th District Veterans Coalition. I know this committee remains committed to helping combat military sexual assault and provide the best care possible for survivors. I encourage this committee to consider incorporating legislation I have introduced, H.R. 3775, the Military Save Act. This legislation would allow victims of military sexual trauma to choose treatment outside of the TRICARE or VA healthcare network that they would feel best fits their particular needs, so long as the care is in response to the MST. The TRICARE or VA system would issue the victim a voucher, which entitles the victim to seek care from a private provider and serves as a promise by TRICARE or the VA to reimburse the private care provider for their services. This legislation can serve as an important tool in our ongoing efforts to help victims of military sexual assault. I'm also aware of the committee's actions to help address mental health issues within the military. Tragically, the recent event at Fort Hood is a painful reminder of how important it is to continue to provide critical mental health services to our service members and veterans. As you know, the VA reported within the 2012 suicide data report that an average of 18 to 22 service members and veterans commit suicide each day. Sadly, according to the latest report published in January by the department, their findings still indicate no clear changes in suicide rates in the total population of Veterans Health Administration users or in male veterans overall. While I believe the DOD and VA are doing the best they can to properly administer many of its new suicide prevention and support programs, I also believe it is up to Congress to continue to provide these departments with the tools and resources they need to do more. I also am concerned about the backlog, the medical claims backlog. It has reached an unacceptable level of 611,000 outstanding medical claims. According to the VA, claims have been reduced by more than 44%, and while I commend the VA on its efforts to reduce the claims backlog, actual reductions vary from facility to facility. Therefore, I urge this committee to commit additional resources to help ensure this issue is quickly resolved. Finally, I ask this committee committee's continued support in increasing public-private partnerships at all arsenals and depots. I represent the Bluegrass Army Depot. Public-private partnerships can play an important role in bringing long-term stability and jobs to communities while increasing revenue to the Army Working Capital Fund. This committee has taken a leadership role in this regard in previous NDAAs, and I encourage this committee to continue to take an active role in this area, in addition to continuing to commit to fully funding the demilitarization efforts at the two remaining depots in Pueblo and in my congressional district in order to fulfill our treaty obligations. And with that, I yield back the balance of my time, and thank you for your leadership on these issues.
Great. Appreciate it. Any questions? Thank you again, Mr. Barr, for your testimony. Appreciate you being with us today.
Thank you.
Now we'll go to the gentleman from Pennsylvania, Mr. Perry. Thanks for your patience. Gentleman's recognized for 4 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to thank the committee for allowing me the opportunity to testify. I want to begin by saying that I'm here in support of a study that includes a traditional force design, force development model. I want to say that everybody must sacrifice, and the reserve component is no different in that regard. But I've asked what's driving this plan because I can't seem to get the facts, and what I see doesn't add up. The theme keeps changing. It started out with the cost, and then it was guard, reserve, their readiness is not where it is. They're not available. Then it changed to they don't do enough collective training. Finally, it was we don't have enough aircraft to do the mission, and they call it stacking, where the aircraft are and the mission set. But I can't get the information on that either. Regarding cost, we say we can't afford the R&D and replacement of the OH-58D. A 64 Echo model costs between $25 and $30 million, yet an OH-58D costs $7.5 million, including the mass-mounted sight. I understand it's a legacy aircraft and we might want to get rid of it, but we have a platform readily available right now flown by the Special Operations Forces, which is the AH-6 or the MH-6, which is a fabulous aircraft. The plan never mentions the cost of retraining everyone currently involved in flying and maintaining the AH-64. It does not validate the need for more UH-60s in the reserve component, and it does not adequately address increased cost of the UH-72 as the primary trainer. Regarding readiness, that we're not ready. The Guard flew more FY-12 AH-64 hours in CONUS than any other Army, any other units in the Army. The flying hour and experience level in the Guard, this is where the experience is, Mr. Chairman. The Guard pilots have 2 to 3 times more hours and experience than their active duty component. It's not a dig on the active component. It's just how it is. When people leave the active component, they come to the Guard. If you really want the metric, look at the Class A accidents in the AH-64 of the last year and where they occurred and why they occurred. We progressed more aviators. We progressed 60 aviators to RL1 in 2 years, not using any additional money. And I would ask, why are we now making reserve component units look different than active unit components? It's not doctrinally correct. Availability. We've mobilized 12 battalions and 4 companies in deployments, and we've answered every single request that has been asked. And I would also say this regarding AH-64 as a reconnaissance platform. If you have to get it to theater, and this is coming from active component, you cannot get it there in a C-17 because it does not land in non-permissive environments. If you can't get the airframe to the fight, what does it matter what the airframe is? You know, you can buy 5 or 6 MH-6s for the cost of one of 64, and you can get it to the fight, which is important. Regarding collective training, that we don't do collective training. I can give you a list of instances, but right off the bat, training with Special Operation Forces Group on active duty bases, joint live fire exercises, air ground integration, monthly JTAC training. I would ask this, why are we requiring battalion level collective training for employment when on employment use a scout weapons team. And I would also say, if you just Google this or go by AKO, the guidance memo for a particular ARB under a certain cab shows that active component ARBs are not training at company level either, and they are focusing on air weapons training proficiency. And that's open source. Regarding mission accomplishments and stacking, I was in a meeting a couple weeks ago, and I was told we don't have enough aircraft to do it. And it was about basing. I said, fine, I agree if that's the case. Show me the plan. We asked last Thursday, what is the plan? What is the requirement? We can't get it. If we can't get it, I think it raises some doubt. And I would also say there's a U.S. Army War College study that says that ARI, the Aviation Restructure Initiative, is resource-driven, not mission-driven. And I would hearken back to a time where we had 58 Sherman and M60 tanks in a unit, and because of capability, we went down to 29 tanks. Where the E-model Apache is wildly capable. I know you're going to cut me off, sir, and I appreciate that. If you remember anything else from this briefing, remember this. We have not been given sufficient facts to support this decision. And I thank you, and I yield back.
Thank the gentleman. Lots of information. If gentleman would indulge, I think the gentleman from Florida has,
sir,
a question.
I just want to thank you for bringing this forward. This is one of the issues that we've been having as it relates to the restructuring, particularly as it relates to the Army National Guard Aviation Unit. My son's an Army aviator in the National Guard, and I think he gets as much or more flight time than his active duty brother. And they're actually, I know, training live fire and everything else this summer for an extended period of time to do all those things that big Army's saying that they're not capable of doing. Plus, that's ignoring the state mission that they have that is hugely important to states like Florida. As it relates to, the plan is to reduce the number of UH-60s in Florida. And you go, how does that work in reality when the Florida Army Aviation Unit has been deployed multiple times into Iraq and Afghanistan, but also into Europe to support that mission? It's amazing that we would cut that resource. And I appreciate your comments in regards to that.
Well, I would just hope, again, that we would follow the paradigm of figuring out what the mission is and then figuring out what the force would look like. This is not following that paradigm that has been followed time and time again.
If you look at, remember, the Army first talked about taking Lakotas away from the National Guard and use those as a training bird at Rucker, and it would have eliminated that whole vast training experience that you currently have at Rucker because they have never flown a Lakota, and they're not durable enough to actually be in a training mission. Because when my son was learning at Rucker, I mean, they pretty well abused those aircraft, and that airframe is not capable of doing that. So I want to thank.
I don't know about the. I wouldn't say it's not necessarily not capable, but it's a two-engine aircraft. The cost is not addressed in this. The OH-58, the TH-67, the Jet Ranger is a highly prolific aircraft.
And what they were telling us, and those that I know that are extremely good pilots were saying that the reason they're not as durable is because they say, well, you don't have to do the type of training with it, but if you did, the actual they'd be replacing skids daily.
Exactly, and the Lakota, having to land with the engine off because you only have one in a 58, the training that you get from that lasts for the rest of your life,
it's
immeasurable. And I would also say this, with all due respect, when we lose this talent pool, which is what we're talking about, talent management, you can run a new aviator through Fort Rucker once a year. Every year you can get a whole crop of new ones. But the proficiency level that you lose from a 4,000 or 5,000-hour aviator is what you don't get. Yes, you have an aviator with 190, 250 hours. But when you're in combat, that 4,500 hours is really what makes the difference. And that will be gone, and you cannot get that quickly. You cannot get that quickly. It takes time and experience, and that's what we're throwing away. There's no operational depth in this plan. So I would just say, let's study it, let's take a look at it, and let's use the method that's been used time and time again, as opposed to this just quick reaction to a budgetary problem, which I understand the considerations, but I think this needs further review.
And my time's expired. I yield back.
Thank you
so much.
Appreciate, again, testimony of the gentleman and the issues he raised. Next, we have the gentlelady from the state of Missouri, Ms. Wagner. Appreciate you being with us. Recognized for 4 minutes.
Thank you very, very much. I appreciate also Vice Chairman Thornberry, the members of the committee. Thanks again for the opportunity to talk about a key defense priority for the United States Navy and our nation, the EA-18G Growler. The 2014 Quadrennial Defense Review notes, and I quote, "In the coming years, countries such as China will continue seeking to counter U.S. strengths using anti-access and aerial denial approaches. Full-spectrum airborne electronic attack has been identified by the Navy and the Department of Defense as a critical and required capability for our forces to effectively and successfully operate in these challenging environments. As the Chief of Naval Operations, Admiral Jonathan Greenert, has stated, control of the electromagnetic spectrum is critical to the warfighting mission today and in the future. As you know, the Growler is the nation's only full-spectrum airborne electronic air attack aircraft. It provides this unique capability off of Navy aircraft carriers and provides support for joint force land bases. It is truly the tip of the spear as our forces enter into contested air environments. Recognizing that there is a warfighting need, the CNO submitted an unfunded priority of 22 additional Growlers for congressional consideration of the fiscal year 2015 defense appropriations. The stakes are quite high, and the time to act is now. Without additional Growlers to meet the Navy's unfunded priority, it is likely that the FA-18 manufacturing line will shutter. To avoid this very predicament, last year, Congress added $75 million in advanced procurement funds for the FA-18 in the fiscal year 2014 Defense Appropriation Act, enough for 22 aircraft. Another critical consideration is the nation's defense industrial base for tactical aviation. Today, there are multiple providers for tactical aviation, sophisticated tactical radars and strike fighter engines. With the end of the FA-18 production, however, DOD will be left with only a single manufacturer in each one of these areas. This scenario limits warfighting surge capacity, it eliminates competition and drives innovation and cost control, and imperils future development programs. Moreover, the FA-18 program supports American manufacturing, including 60,000 jobs, 800 different suppliers and vendors, and provides $3 billion in annual economic impact. For these reasons, I have authored a House letter to your committee asking for consideration of the Navy's unfunded priority of additional Growlers. I hope it demonstrates to you that there is a broad bipartisan support for this request across Congress to support both the warfighter and the defense industrial base. I look forward to working with this committee and supporting the process as the National Defense Authorization Act moves through the House of Representatives, and I thank you.
Thank the gentlelady. Any questions? Great. Appreciate the gentlelady being here and for her testimony on this issue. Next, we'll have the gentleman from Arkansas, Mr. Crawford. Full written statement will be made part of the record, and the gentleman's recognized for 4 minutes for whatever comments you'd like to make.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good morning, Ranking Member Smith, Chairman McKeon, distinguished members of the committee. I thank you for the work you do to preserve the security of our great nation and for allowing me to testify before the full committee. Regarding explosive ordnance disposal priorities for fiscal year 2015 and the National Defense Authorization Act, I myself served in the Army as an EOD tech and proud to be a co-founder along with committee member Susan Davis of the House EOD Caucus. EOD soldiers, sailors, airmen, and Marines are the military's preeminent team of warrior explosive experts. They're trained and equipped to identify and neutralize explosives used by terrorist networks across the globe. EOD techs protect their fellow military personnel and civilians from these threats while providing support across a wide range of military and civilian national security operations. EOD forces have proven to be game changers in attacking and dismantling terror cells and associated networks. These forces will continue to be indispensable assets for the foreseeable future, supporting counterterrorism operations, building the capacity of partner nations, and protecting the homeland through providing support to civil law enforcement agencies at federal, state, and local levels. There are an estimated 66,000 call-outs annually across the United States on explosive ordnance by interagency, military, EOD, and public safety bomb squads. Army EOD units responding under immediate response authority have historically departed their home station installation within 30 minutes of notification during duty hours and 60 minutes off duty, 365 days a year. On these civil support missions, EOD provides support to civil law enforcement agencies, but they do not perform law enforcement activities. The Boston bombings serve as a stark reminder of the threat of terrorist detonation of explosives in the United States have revealed gaps in the nation's ability to defeat a sustained bombing campaign in the homeland. I note that military EOD immediate response included the 387th Ordnance Company EOD from Camp Edwards, Massachusetts, which responded to 64 call-outs during the Boston bombing. However, I have concern that following these attacks, the Army Forces Command issued guidance that the local staff judge advocate must review every civil authority request for emergency EOD response prior to sending aid to ensure the support does not violate the Posse Comitatus Act of 1878. In addition, the guidance requires that a senior commander, normally a three to two-star general, must then approve each of these EOD immediate responses and must ensure that civil authorities will reimburse the Army as a condition of immediate response. I understand the need to ensure that EOD is compliant with Posse Comitatus and any of its civil support missions, but it's vital that we do not overcorrect and negatively impact the ability of our EOD forces to provide increasingly needed and immediate support to our civilian law enforcement agencies. It's further problematic that under the recent Army Forces Command guidance, the responding EOD units must now seek reimbursement from local, state, and federal law enforcement as a precondition for providing the requested military EOD support. On April 4, 2014, I met with the general officer that has the training readiness authority for the Army Forces Command EOD units. I have grave concerns over his proposed reorganization of the Army EOD force structure, reorganization of Army EOD force modernization and branch proponents, and reorganization and restationing of EOD tactical units and EOD institutional activities. The significance as well as the irreversibility of these proposed actions deserves the committee's close scrutiny and oversight, and I respectfully request that you and the committee seek more information and further require the department to justify these proposed changes before permitting any of them to proceed. We must also ensure that our EOD units, like the 387th out of Massachusetts, are properly equipped to respond to explosive threats in cities and towns throughout the homeland. The MRAP vehicles for EOD operations in Afghanistan are a good place to field excess MRAPs to the Army National Guard EOD units, comprising one-third of Army EOD force need response vehicles like the MRAP. As I am running low on time, I'll just continue to submit these statements for the record and just ask for your consideration. And any questions you might have, I'd be happy to answer them.
Great. Any questions? I appreciate the gentleman's input on these issues and his continued leadership and expertise, which we will continue to take advantage of. So I appreciate very much the gentleman being here. Next, we'll turn to the state of North Carolina. Distinguished gentleman, Mr. Hudson. Appreciate you being here. Recognized for 4 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to thank you and Chairman McKeon, Ranking Member Smith, for the opportunity to share with you some of the national security priorities that I hold for the upcoming year on behalf of the 8th District of North Carolina. As I travel around my communities in my district in North Carolina, people have consistently told me that restoring fiscal responsibility is their number one priority, and they sent me to Washington to force the government to live within its means. Accordingly, I'm committed to cutting spending, reducing the size of government, promoting economic growth, and balancing our budget. That means we have to focus on priorities like a strong national defense. Today, I would like to discuss a number of issues, namely the challenges that we face along with our allies and partners, the commitments we have made to our men and women in uniform, and the importance of ensuring accountability and transparency when trying to maintain a strong national defense in a very tough budget environment. While we've seen the gradual reduction of core al-Qaeda influence, it's important to remember that we continue to be engaged in a global conflict against increasingly fractionalized groups that seek to do us harm, along with the states that support them. A failure to exercise U.S. diplomatic and military leadership means nuclear states like Iran and North Korea will be able to bully the international community both through direct means and through their proxies. North Carolina is fortunate to be home to over 700,000 proud veterans, and I'm fortunate to represent a district that has a strong military presence given its proximity to Fort Bragg. I just returned from a productive visit to Camp McCall, an extension of Fort Bragg, where some of America's finest trained to become part of the Special Forces, and I'm pleased to report on their fine work. The men and women at Fort Bragg have matchless capabilities and a unique mission. I look forward to continuing to working with the base to ensure their priorities are met when it comes to equipment, facilities, and training. As the United States increases its special operations and airborne operations presence, it's critically important that we support in-depth training and techniques an area where Fort Bragg continues to excel. I look forward to working with you and this committee to provide the necessary resources to ensure the utmost success for our dedicated men and women in uniform there. While I recognize this committee does not intend to reauthorize or make changes to the authorization of military force this year, I would still like to take a moment to touch on the issue, given its continued importance in regards to civil liberties and our ability to effectively prosecute terrorists. I would like this committee to note that I will not support trading our guaranteed civil liberties for the promise of security. With that said, I also refuse to stand by and allow terrorists to be treated as common criminals. The administration has taken this stance when it comes to pursuing those involved in the deadly September 11th attack on the U.S. Embassy in Benghazi, and we've all seen the failure and results this approach has led to. Waiving subpoenas in the face of radical militants is simply not the way to protect America's interests. This approach is also apparent in the administration's attempt to close the prison in Guantanamo Bay and transfer over 150 terrorists to U.S. soil or return them home to their home nations. I cannot and will not support policies like this that threaten Americans around the world. The United States is a nation built on the premise of liberty and constitutional rights. We preserve a unique separation of powers so that we can ensure not one branch has too much power. The programs in the NDAA, like any other, fall within that system, and it's our duty as elected representatives to ensure it does not violate our privacy or civil liberties. Thanks to the committee for the opportunity to speak today, and thank you for your commitment to our nation's warfighters and their families. Thank you. I yield back.
Appreciate the gentleman, and committee appreciates his input. Thank you for your testimony. Next, we have the distinguished gentleman from California, Mr. Nunes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'll just have a brief statement for the record, and I'm also submitting it for the record.
And without objection, we previously made any written materials you want to include, including your full written statement, part of our record.
And I also have a slide that I'd like to draw your attention to as I'm giving my statement. I'd like to submit the GAO report for the record titled Defense Headquarters, DOD Needs to Reassess Options for Permanent Locations of U.S. Africa Command. Amid the challenging budgetary situation now facing the U.S. military, opportunities for significant cost savings have been identified in AFRICOM's operations. I am proposing the relocation of AFRICOM headquarters stateside. The Government Accountability Office, GAO, reported that the transfer would save $60 to $70 million annually. Additionally, GAO estimated that the move would create 4,300 U.S.-based jobs and infuse $350 to $450 million into the local economy. The office found no, and I want to repeat, no substantiating evidence or rationale for the DOD's decision to keep AFRICOM headquarters in Germany. In fact, the placement of AFRICOM's headquarters in Germany was supposed to be temporary and was done merely out of convenience since it was spawned out of EUCOM. This proposal would move AFRICOM stateside and have it operate much like CENTCOM and SOUTHCOM, which have their headquarters stateside with forward operating locations near the theater in order to conduct operations. In conjunction with this transfer, I would also say that Lajes Field Base, which is in the middle of the Atlantic Ocean, should serve as a forward operating base and logistical hub for AFRICOM. The Azores base recently has had $150 million in upgrades to it. It is really one of the Taj Mahals of all U.S. Air Force bases around the globe. And it's really not being used, and in fact, USAFE is trying to close the base. I think this would be a strategic error, as I presented to this committee last year. And I was thankful, actually, that this committee found that was a very poor decision on behalf of USAFE. And that's why this committee put in the bill last year strong language that said that no troops should be withdrawn. In addition, Defense Appropriations put in a similar rider. And so what I've been looking to do is how do you save money and also get our warfighters closer to the battlefield and create efficiencies? I believe that this is a strong way to do it, and I would urge the committee to give it serious consideration. And with that, Mr. Chairman, I'd like to yield back for questions.
Well, let me just say I appreciate the gentleman's leadership on this issue and continuing to raise questions about current plans and better options, and I appreciate the material that the gentleman has submitted. I think that will benefit the committee in looking at these issues. So, again, thank you for being here. Thank you for your testimony.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
And with that, the committee stands adjourned.